the 1909 meeting of the IOC in Berlin, representatives from the German capital threw their comically large 1909 hats in the ring to host the games in 1912, a pretty short 3-year lead time to put on the contest. As we discussed in the past episode, the IOC struck a deal with the German and Swedish representatives, giving Stockholm the 1912 games and the 1916 games to Berlin. At the 1912 meeting, held concurrently with the 1912 Stockholm Olympics, the IOC officially selected Berlin, throwing away unlikely bids from Alexandria, Egypt, Amsterdam, Brussels, Budapest, and Cleveland, Ohio. These cities really had no chance of hosting the games, since Berlin had been chosen behind closed doors 3 years earlier, but wouldn't a Cleveland 1916 Olympics have been grand? We live in a universe where St. Louis and almost Cleveland hosted the Olympics, but New York and Chicago haven't. If the city of Cleveland could be compared to Ohio's own blue streak at Cedar Point, in 1916, Cleveland was about here.
And we see the disintegration of the city in its core. Men, I think it's clear that the people expect that we will bring this disintegration which has set in to an end.
Work on the games in Berlin waited until the bid was official, commencing in 1912. A site on Berlin's western outskirts was chosen, a large racetrack and sports complex on the northern edge of Grunewald, a forest adjacent to the Wannsee, was chosen. The Kaiser bulldozed over the recently constructed Grunewald racecourse and got the architect who designed the building he just bulldozed to design a new building, but better this time. Beleaguered architect Otto March designed a brand new 33,000 capacity stadium, larger than Stockholm's, but not as large as London's. As there wasn't an official report compiled for these 1916 Olympics, for soon-to-be-evident reasons, I don't actually know how many marks Wilhelm II put into this thing, but they hustled and finished it in under a year, 3 years early for the games. Okay, let's fast forward a bit. We've heard this part a bunch of times before. World War I started because some guy shot some other guy, a lot of people are dying, everything is terrible in Europe, and large parts of many other continents also. Now it's 1915. World War I, or as it was called back then, World War, was stuck in a stalemate on both European fronts, but for some reason the German government couldn't let the Olympic dream die. They believed their victory was so imminent that plans for the games continued to be drafted well into late 1915. First on the agenda, the UK, France, Italy, Serbia, Russia, any other non-central powers, banned. The US and Japan, probably banned, but we'll see about that in the future. These 1916 Olympics were to be central powers approved, and conveniently for the German team, would help eliminate four of the nations that beat them at the previous Olympiad, certainly putting them in the top of the medal count. The IOC and its French-ass president Pierre de Coubertin weren't having any of that. Oh my goodness, banning nations from a supposedly apolitical sports gathering because they happen to be on the other side of a war? That's not what we're all about at all. He fielded very last-minute bids from more American cities, like Chicago, New York, San Francisco, Philadelphia, and most puzzlingly, Newark, New Jersey. Don't forget about Cleveland, they were still in the running too. If the city of Newark's population could be compared to New Jersey's own King de Ka at Six Flags Great Adventure, in 1916 Newark was about here. Faced with the prospect of holding the 1916 Olympics in New Jersey, Pierre decided to cancel the games altogether. Pierre did it in the most hilariously dickish way, though. Instead of just canceling the Sixth Olympics, or moving them to a new city, Pierre still counted the Berlin Games as the Sixth Olympics. They only existed on paper. Berlin in the summer of 1916 was alive with frontline newspaper propaganda, not tennis scores. And when the 1920 Olympics would come around, they would be the 7th Olympics rather than the 6th. In Pierre's mind, the Germans had their Olympics, they just blew it. In the summer of 1916, no nations would win any Olympic medals, but they would receive many medals of a different kind. Less than a year after the war's end, the IOC holds their first meeting in 5 years. In Lucerne, Switzerland, they tackle a major problem. They promised the games to Antwerp, Belgium, but Antwerp happened to be right in the middle of some of the most intense fighting of World War I, and was pretty messed up. Almost all of the city's sports facilities were damaged in some way, because almost all of the city's anything was damaged in some way. Lyon, France, which escaped the Great War relatively unscathed, physically at least, offered to host the games instead. Budapest and Havana also put in their bids, as did Atlanta, Philly, and Cleveland again. Faced with the choice between holding the Olympics in Cleveland or in the bombed-out ruin of Antwerp, Pierre chose the latter. But how could he not have? In a major propaganda coup for the new post-war European order, France and Britain could put on their games on schedule in 1920, showing post-war unity of the Allied nations through friendly sports competition, and showing off the speedy recovery of Belgium all in one fell swoop. Germany, Austria, Hungary, Bulgaria, of course, banned! And to represent the whole enterprise, and more grandly, Pierre and the Olympic movement's semi-hypocritical, blandly humanist vision, Coubertin busts out the Olympic flag, with one ring to represent the peoples of each continent, except the ones who are bad and not allowed to play with us. From left to right, first, of course, a blue ring representing Europe, the premier continent, and the blue-skinned people there. Asia, the second best continent. Represented with yellow, and the yellow-skinned people there. Finally, Africa, the winner of the Old World bronze medal, is in black. Perhaps that's a too pessimistic view of it. Yes, African participation in the Olympics at this era was terrible, with only South Africa fielding an all-white team. But the Africa ring isn't just the third ring in the Olympic flag, it's also the central one, the ring every other ring expands out from. So, hey, you know, it goes both ways. Maybe that's a better interpretation of it. Anyway, the flag is rounded off with a green ring for Australia and the Pacific, a color chosen at random, I assume, and finally a red ring for America, the last and best continent.
In Newfoundland and Labrador, we have a very different outlook on life.
Pierre also devised a second meaning for the symbol. According to some advanced vexillological calculus I cannot follow, you can apparently make the color of every country on Earth's flag in 1913 with these five colors, plus white, which I think is at least mostly still true today, maybe not exactly, I'm not entirely sure. With only about 15 months to plan the games, and around 5 million francs to do it, major corners were cut. Roughly half of the financing came from the Belgian government, with the Antwerp municipal and provincial government accounting for about a quarter, and the national government footing the bill for the rest. The other half was donated by wealthy philanthropists. Only about 5% of the meager cost was recouped by ticket sales, which was terrible in comparison to Stockholm, which actually sold a lot of tickets. The long shadow of World War I and the Spanish flu pandemic had ground European infrastructure and enthusiasm to a halt. The pall of this Olympics extended to every corner of its development and planning. Advanced ticket sales were essentially non-existent, worrying promoters that the games would be a financial burden on the state, which they of course ended up being. And attendance would be so spotty throughout the games, the organizers would eventually just cave and make the tickets free by the closing days of the ceremony. There's nothing sadder than an empty stadium at the Olympics. That stadium in question is the Olympisch Stadion, generally referred to now as the Kiel Stadion after the Kiel neighborhood it inhabits. The whole thing was built in 9 months, opening a few months ahead of the games, but in a hilarious turn of events, ended up being finished after the Olympics ended, Hopefully that won't happen again. Far from hiring a superstar architect like Torben Groot, the games hired a no-name. Literally, I don't know the name of the person who designed this stadium. There's also like two pictures of it from this period, which is not a sign of a building people found particularly interesting or important. It looks a bit like the Stockholm Arena in miniature, with one row of bleacher seating on its sides and little towers on each end. It seems like there might have been a temporary second floor installed, but it's kind of unclear from the very limited documentation we have of the place. The capacity today of the stadium that inhabits the area where this old stadium was is 12,500, but at the games, the old stadium could allegedly hold 30,000. It's also worth pointing out that while this arena does still exist, kind of, it's basically been completely rebuilt as a gray brutalist claw. What's it up to now? It hosts the K Beerschot VA, a Belgian soccer team owned by some Saudi prince that plays in the Proximus League, which is the second tier of Belgian pro soccer. The stadium was built in Kiel, about 3.5 miles from the city center, an hour's walk, which in 1920s Europe was practically suburbia. It was served by a tram line, however, that sent you right into the center of the city in about 15 minutes, which, also because it's Europe, still exists, which is nice. The most difficult cutback for me was the absolute dearth of footage of these games. Stockholm in 1912 had hours of professionally shot footage of all the main events, and some of the not main events, but these games couldn't afford such an expense. The IOC didn't hire an in-house cinematographer, so the scarce footage we have comes from Swedish independent newsreel producers, and there isn't much of it left, only the highlights from the major events, under 15 minutes in total. Despite the slim budget, the sports program brought back some old favorites cut in Sweden's streamlining. Boxing was back after Swedish protest in 1912. Archery, field hockey, and alas, polo were back. The final re-addition to the program was weightlifting, which had been last contested in St. Louis in 1904. All of this, plus everything from Stockholm, meant a pretty crowded program spread pretty thin across a very narrow budget. Not to mention a demonstration of korfball, a game invented 20 years prior in the Netherlands. A sort of Pepsi to basketball's Coke, the game involves getting a ball through a ring, like basketball, but when you have the ball you can't move with it, unlike in basketball. You can only pivot. Also returning from London are winter sports. These would be the last summer games to have a winter component, as the Winter Olympics were introduced in 1924. Speaking of, let's begin the sports talk with the winter sports. Firstly, the figure skating.
Les Flamands dedans se sont rien dit.
It's April at the Palais de Glace d'Anvers, Antwerp's only ice rink. Antwerp's only ice rink was humble, but with artistic girders and light bulbs, it's interesting to see how unspectacular the old Olympic venues really could be. This looks like the place an Olympic hockey team might practice in, but I'm sure it would be considered hopelessly understated for the big day. Like the stadium, the Antwerp Ice Palace is also gone, first replaced with a parking garage, and then some new apartment buildings. Another thing you'll only find in Europe, replacing a parking garage with apartment buildings. It's interesting to note how ephemeral this Olympics' physical footprint was. None of the original constructions for the games remain, which I think is perhaps the only Olympics where that's true. The International Skating Union protested the games, opting out of administering the contest due to the IOC's ban on the former Central Powers athletes. 9 men and 6 women competed, all but one of each were European. The Scandinavians in particular dominated the field. Sweden's team was anchored by Ulrich Salchow, but he was outshone by teammate Gillis Grafström. Post-war unity was also showing cracks, with each of the European judges preferring different skaters, usually the ones from their own country. An eternal problem, if you will. Ice hockey. Debuting at these games was ice hockey, also held in the Ice Palace. This might have been viewed as an odd inclusion, as the sport hadn't yet reached true global popularity. The game was still predominantly a Can-American pastime. Belgium fielded a team that came in dead last, and the Belgian audience, largely unfamiliar with the rules of the game or how it was played, watched the favored nations cruise to medals, in complete confusion. Due to Antwerp's rushed nature, the Canadians didn't have a chance to put together a national team, so opted for their best amateur squad, the Winnipeg Falcons, a non-college-affiliated amateur team comprised mostly of Icelandic-Canadian immigrants. The Americans and Canadians quickly knocked out their much weaker European opponents in two hilariously lopsided games. The Americans beat Switzerland 29-0, and the Canadians, with characteristic politeness, stopped after a 15-0 defeat against Czechoslovakia. In the other bracket, Sweden, one of the better hockey countries in Europe, handily defeats Belgium 8-0 and France 4-0. Winnipeg defeats America narrowly 2-0 at the semifinal, essentially clinching them the gold. All they had to do was take out much weaker Sweden, which they did in a 12-1 game to make the whole thing official. Amazingly, these regional champions from Winnipeg knocked out their only true competition, the United States, and then just cut through the rest of the hockey world like butter. It was an odd and lopsided contest in more ways than one. Also peculiar is the tournament setup. That tournament I just described only determined the first place winner. Sweden didn't get a silver medal for coming in second to Canada. Two more tournaments would take place between the remaining nations to come up with second and third place. In the second tournament, America again destroys Sweden's chances of victory 7-0 and beats Czechoslovakia 16-0. These are rough scores. Finally, in the third and last tournament, Sweden is again bested, this time narrowly by the Czechoslovakian team. It's interesting to point out that since the American team was about 40% Canadian-Americans, Canada sort of won one and a half of the three possible medals here. They really are the kings of hockey.
Here's danger. The enemy closing in. A shot. A save.
We can breathe again.
That's hockey. That's our game.
That ends the little springtime winter sports prelude, as these were all held in April, not quite winter. They're supposed to also try out a skiing contest for this winter sports program, but since Belgium's highest mountain looks like this, they gave up on that. Art competition. Since they also didn't give up on the weird art contest bit. Five competitions were held in architecture, literature, music, painting, and sculpture, like last time. Unlike last time, the competition was much smaller and less internationally esteemed. I've never heard of any of the medalists, and a couple of the contests only had one or two entrants, so hopefully they stop doing this. Archery. Let's begin the actual competition with the archery. Returning after 12 years, the archery event was characteristically uninteresting. Only fielding archers from Belgium and its parents, the Netherlands and France, the victor was 54-year-old Hubert van Innes, who had won the same Olympic title 20 years earlier at the Paris Olympics. The most spectacular part of the proceeding was the setting, held in Nachtegalen Park, a sprawling, charmingly overgrown park on the southern edge of Antwerp's old city, which is now partly a giant freeway interchange and tunnel. Gymnastics. Like the archery, this was a bit of a mess. The same bickering about which style of gymnastics to use, German, Swedish, or the free system, continued, despite Germany's absence. Again, a compromise using all three systems in separate contests was devised, robbing the contest of any competitive stakes. The squabbling didn't stop there. Even practitioners of the same style would argue about unfair judging. In the free system contest, there were two nations only, Denmark and Norway, and two judges, one from Denmark and one from Norway. Instead of replacing them with more neutral choices, the contest nearly deadlocked as each judge gave their favorite gymnast the edge. Athletics. Again, these were the main events. Maybe I should put these at the end, considering this is kind of like the part of the Olympics people care the most about, especially back then, before, you know, like, soccer and basketball became big. But whatever, I'm gonna just keep to my alphabetical system. One of the few sports at Antwerp with truly international participation, though, these athletic events were the most competitive of the games. America was the track superpower leading into the games after having picked up the majority of medals at each previous Olympiad. The American team was untested, though, as World War I had destroyed peaceful international competition. There had basically been no international track meets since 1912. Nobody knew who the world's fastest man was. The American runners Charles Paddock, Morris Kirksey, and Alan Woodring proved an able bunch of sprinters, though, guaranteeing medals for the U.S. in the sprinting. The days of complete American domination in track and field, however, were over. The middle distances go to Commonwealth runners, notably Philip Noel Baker, the silver medalist in the 1500 meters. Noel Baker became famous as a longtime peace activist, labor MP, and Nobel laureate, the only Nobel laureate with an Olympic medal. The other famous name in the distance races was Paavo Nurmi, the second flying Finn, known contemporaneously as the Phantom Finn, to differentiate himself from the previous flying Finn. Nurmi took up Hans Kolomeinen's ascetic training practices. Hoping to replicate Kolomeinen's gold medal streak from 1912, Paavo Nurmi applied analytical precision to his 5K and 10K runs, measuring each lap time meticulously, starting with a furious burst of speed and decreasing in speed logarithmically as the race progressed, allowing him to maintain a consistent pace despite increasing tiredness. Nurmi was the only runner to bring a stopwatch on the 5K, finishing the run at exactly 15 minutes, on the dot, exactly. His main rival, France's Joseph Guillemot, took a different approach. 22-year-old Guillemot was a year from his discharge from the military after World War I. Despite a mustard gas attack that left him permanently incapable of breathing from his right lung, he returned to the front. While Nurmi brought a stopwatch to the race, Guillemot took a pack of cigarettes. He smoked one before the race, and then 14 minutes and 56 seconds later, in 4 seconds less than Nurmi, came in first. I'm assuming he smoked another cigarette afterwards. Interestingly, both the health-conscious Finn and Joseph Guillemot lived to the exact same age, 75. In the 10K rematch, Guillemot returned, replacing the previous French champion Jean Buin, who was killed in World War I. Nurmi's strict pacing carried him to victory in this event, finishing in 33 minutes and 48 seconds, a full minute ahead of Guillemot. The Americans dominate the hurdles and the sprint race, although gold medalist in the 110 meters, Canadian-American Earl Thompson, wins it for his birth country of Canada, outrunning both the world record and the camera. The race walking, a bizarre pair of events, yielding an equally bizarre champion. The hour-long gyration festival returned in 1920, and Italian Ugo Frigerio picked up both walking golds. Supposedly, he handed out special sheet music to the conductor of the stadium orchestra so he could keep rhythm to the music. And during his walk, would have brief shouting conversations with the very few audience members, often trying to hype up the barren stands. In the jumps and throws, American dominance further eroded, with Scandinavian jumpers and throwers ever better, but they remained the strongest nation by the end of proceedings. American chances in the jumps faltered when favorite Saul Butler, one of the first black football quarterbacks in the United States, pulled a muscle. William Peterson of Sweden won instead, but the Americans held onto the high jump record. Yale man Dick Landon returned to Connecticut with a gold medal and a new girlfriend, Olympic diver Alice Lord. The marathon is the most dramatic of these events, so I've saved it for last. But even then, was it so dramatic? Nobody died like last time, thankfully. Nobody almost died, like in 1904, also thankfully. And the finish rate was the best ever, 73%, including Shizu Kanakuri, the Japanese marathonist, who dipped out of the Stockholm Marathon and was declared missing before finishing the race decades later. Kanakuri finished this time with an impressive 16th place. At mile 13, the final podium was already leading, with Hannes Kolomeinen, the original Flying Finn, fighting with Estonian Yuri Lossman, Belgian Auguste Bruce, and Italian Valerio Adi. Kolomeinen edged Lossman out by 10 seconds, only pulling ahead in the final sprint, his strict religious pacing paying off at the final drag. The track itself was, per usual, a tour of unspectacular countryside. Instead of a complicated route through Antwerp's dense, historic core, The marathon runners are sent to Flanders Fields, a flat expanse of crops, little towns like Artselaar, Riet, Roomst, and Warloos, tree-lined byways, pockmarked in-betweens, before finishing the perfectly flat course in the little town of Kontich.
Une valse à trois temps, qui s'offre encore le temps, qui s'offre encore le temps de s'offrir des détours.
Boxing, or English boxing, as it was called by the organizers, was back after being deemed too coarse for Sweden in 1912. At a temporary outdoor boxing ring erected at the Antwerp Zoo, eight weight classes produced eight interesting champions, among them Americans Frankie Gennaro and Sam Mossberg, two scrappers from New York's Lower East Side ghetto. Two of Canada's champs were from similarly humble beginnings as well, welterweight gold medalist Bert Schneider and middleweight bronze medalist Mo Herskovich, both hailed from Montreal's Jewish quarter, Griffintown. Herskovich is the only boxer we still have footage of, albeit mislabeled as Hershvich. His opponent is shown as an American named Norton, but Herskovich defeated a Dutchman named Munting and a South African named Bradley, but no Norton as far as I can tell, so this guy is likely Munting or Bradley. In fact, no Norton boxed in 1920 at all, so I don't know where this name came from. The clip is a little sliver of a pretty ferocious contest. The boxing is much nastier than the current Olympic rendition of the sport, closer to TV boxing that you might think of, you know. There's no pads, and the fighters are pulled apart by the ref towards the end here. Herskovich came back from Antwerp happy with his bronze. He lived a particularly dangerous life. On top of boxing, he was also a rugby player and a World War I machine gunner. One other dark detail I found from Herskovich's life was apparently, while at a beach in suburban Quebec in the 1940s, he was attacked by an anti-Semitic mob and blinded in one eye. I'm a little bit cautious about including this because the only place I can find it is on Wikipedia, and it cites a news story in an Ontario newspaper I can't find. But there is, weirdly, a lot of evidence of Canadian beachside anti-Semitism, including all of these signs found from similar places and times. Cycling. In addition to a road course, track cycling at the Garden City Velodrome, which is Dutch for velodrome. A handy tip for Dutch is it's basically just, if you want to know the Dutch word for something, it's the English word, but funnier sounding. The road course was also brought back. It was again quite long, a 110-mile flat loop to Turnhout and back, finished in 4 hours and 40 minutes by the Swede Harry Stenqvist. Like everything at this Olympics, the contest ran into a number of errors. Unlike at Stockholm, the riders all left at once, avoiding the confusion of staggered finishes, which is nice, but blockages by drawbridges and train tracks had to be deducted from the final scores, meaning that it was still not a pretty clear race. Stenqvist actually arrived back in Antwerp third, almost a minute behind Frenchman Fernand Cantaloube and the presumed winner South Africa's Henry Kaltenbrun. Stenqvist was retroactively awarded the victory, though, after the refs did the math. They subtracted the time he had to wait for drawbridges to open and train tracks to, you know, the train to pass. And I guess they determined that he actually finished the course the quickest. But I'm sure this must have annoyed the spectators and the second and third place cyclists. Diving. Our first aquatic event takes us to the Stade Nautique, a pretty grandiose name for the water event's temporary digs. Erected quick and cheap, it was less of a stadium and more of a wrought iron and wood tower next to a ship canal, a section of Antwerp's ship canals, which also occasionally doubled as Antwerp's sewer, were sectioned off for the water polo, diving, and swimming. Contrast this industrial landscape with Stockholm's Sylvan Riverbank. The canal cut below sea level in the damp Flemish muck affords the venue a sense of remoteness, a sort of edge of the worldness, if you will. International competition in the diving was pretty minimal. America and Sweden traded podium sweeps, first the Americans in the springboard, then Sweden in the high diving.
My name is Jan Janssen, I come from Wisconsin.
The American men's springboard triad of Kuhn, Pinkston, and Ballback steamrolled through stiff competition from Sweden, but the American women were literally uncontested, with only four entrants, all American, facing off against each other in the women's springboard. The unlikely winners were Eileen Riggin and Helen Wainwright, both aged 14, two of the 10 youngest Olympic medalists ever. Equestrian. Horse sport returns with dressage, eventing, jumping, and vaulting. Aren't jumping and vaulting the same thing, you may be thinking? The universe will never have an answer to this question. I've made my feelings about the equestrian sports known. I'm still confused why this obscure rich man's pursuit is given equal footing with other sports, sports like basketball and soccer, which have decades of international popularity and influence on global culture, and is given more legitimacy than certain other sports like baseball and cricket, which are excluded from the games, with same international popularity and influence on global culture. I guess I'm not confused. I know perfectly well why, because equestrian sports were popular amongst the class of people who founded the modern Olympics. And unlike polo and croquet, which we are thankfully rid of, equestrian is for some reason a particularly resilient remnant of that original Olympic class. It feels especially difficult to justify, however, at Antwerp. These Olympics, as I have stated over and over, were the Allied world's attempt to project post-war unity, a sense of recovery from the horrors of World War I. A propaganda coup in the guise of an apolitical sporting event. Nothing new and nothing old. These games were also branded as a celebration of peace. This equestrian contest at this Olympics and every early Olympics was for the officer class, however. It was a sport by and for the people who had plunged Europe into that recent chapter of darkness, and despite Antwerp's exclusion of the German and Austro-Hungarian horse-backed oligarchs, us present-day people understand that they were but one half of the whole rotten coin. It's hard to watch such fabulously aristocratic names as Roland, Comte de Maille de la Tour Langerie, Emmanuel de Blomart de Sille, Count Morner, and Izard Baron Sirtima van Grovesteins do this horsey bullshit in a city so devastated by their ilk, and to see it paraded around as some sort of post-war justice. It lays out how blatantly untrue the War to End All Wars moniker was to become. As long as there were guys like this riding around, war would be here to stay. The best horse names from this contest? Jehovah, Perfect Gentleman, and Dick. Fencing. Despite the venue, the Egmont Palace, a 16th century checkerboard of bespoke courtyards and archways, and also despite fencing's reputation in this day and age, the fencing contest was not the bougie circle jerk that the equestrian contest I just finished complaining about was. Every inch of that palace, the only venue of the games held in Brussels, and not in Antwerp, was jam-packed with Belgian fencing fanatics. Fencing enjoyed popular appeal in 1920, Belgium, and even though I'm sure the absence of the Hungarian sabreurs due to the post-war ban upset a few fans, it was still one of the most viewed contests of the games. Those gruff Hungarian Jewish sabreurs mentioned in episodes past were of course banned along with the rest of the Hungarian team. Exploiting this new opening, the Nadi brothers, Aldo and Nato Nadi, entered all three fencing disciplines, épée, foil, and saber. The brothers won golds in all three team events, anchoring three different fencing teams focusing on wildly different disciplines. Shit better get played in the palace. I can't treat niggas like big deals. Why put up a front? I'm callous. Bald. I look like Ray Allen. Field hockey. A rather obscure sport at this period, and I guess arguably in our period as well, unless you live in South Asia, little was written about this small tournament. Only Britain, Denmark, Belgium, and France sent teams to this, and this was far from an internationally beloved sport. At least now, field hockey enjoys some popularity in the Commonwealth, as I said, but in 1920, athletes from India and elsewhere in the British Empire, where the game was gaining popularity, were still excluded from the games. On top of how few teams there were, the games were generally uninteresting. Either two bad teams went up against each other and scored minimally, or Britain steamrolled over the much weaker teams, culminating in the hometown humiliation where Britain beat Belgium 12-1. Football. FIFA was tasked with drawing international competition for these games, and was pretty successful. Obviously, Germany, Austria, Hungary, etc. were banned. I don't know how many times I'm going to say this. But some new teams entered the fray, including Egypt, and the new post-war countries of Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia. All three of those were immediately eliminated, or in the case of Czechoslovakia, ejected from the game. I'll get to that in a second. But hey, it's a start. The British loss here is the most interesting part of this mostly unfilmed tournament. Britain won 3 of the last 5 Olympic titles, and likely would have won the other 2 in 1896 and 1904 if they had entered. International soccer, like all sports, was still reeling from a lack of competition during the war years, but the English team in 1920, as in 2024, was one of the best in the world. In 1920, they were ranked somewhere between number 4 and number 1. The international rankings back then were a little bit more fast and loose than they are today. Add on to that team any additional talent from the Scottish, Welsh, and Irish sides, and you had one of the most dominant teams in international soccer in the 1920s. ILO ratings are imperfect and obviously couldn't quantify the differences in the game, you know, 100 years can make, but the English team's ILO score in 1920 was about 2,000, and now it's also about 2,000. The winning Norwegian team, the team that knocked England out of the Olympic contest in that first round, was sitting at 1564, on par with how the Cameroonian team stacks up here in 2024. This means a team 500 points lower on the ELO rating, which would be 70 slots lower in the international rankings today, somehow not only won, but won by a lot. They beat the Brits 3-1. Two of those goals alone came from Yeye Gundersen. This would be a very rare instance in international soccer of a top 5 ranked team in the world getting knocked out of a major international competition in its first game. You soccer nerds, let me know if that's happened again, but I really doubt it. The final was yet another bizarre game in this tournament. Czechoslovakia, in their international debut, had made it to the final against host Belgium. Czechoslovakia was halfway through the game, down 2 points, but still very much in the running for the championship. Throughout the game, the Czechoslovakians complained about unfair calls, particularly what they viewed as frivolous fouls. Nearing the end of the first half, the Czechoslovakian team just decides to walk off in protest. FIFA officials rush down to the field in hopes of ironing things out, hoping to get the Czechoslovakians back on the field to finish the game, but they're pissed and they're not coming back. Belgium is awarded the title by forfeit, Belgium's only gold medal in a team sport at this Olympics, and one of only 14 golds they would rake in at the entire thing. Surely the fans were happy, but this couldn't have been the way they wanted Belgium to win. The modern pentathlon. In a rerun of 8 years ago, the Swedes sweep the modern pentathlon again. If you want an explanation for what that event is, you know, watch the previous episode in 1912 when it's explained. Instead of two guys named Gösta and a guy named Georg winning, it's one guy named Gösta and then a guy named Eric. This contest was both unreported and therefore likely uninteresting, so I will move on. To the polo. Oh, goddammit. Taking place at the Wellington Racetrack in Ostend, which is most famous for hosting the 46th show of Bon Jovi's Bounce Tour. Polo was again unfortunately included in the program. Like the field hockey, only 4 teams competed: Britain, Spain, the United States, and Belgium. Home team Belgium were immediately eliminated, per usual, and the rest shared the medals. On the Spanish team, a procession of quite long names befitting a count, 2 dukes, and a marquis. The lone non-noble on the Spanish team was literally the Spanish Prime Minister's son, José de Figueroa y Alonso Martínez, so not quite a man of the people. He was actually 2 months later, after the games, killed by Berber Republicans resisting Spanish colonial expansion in the Sahara. So that is the general social milieu we are talking about here. Rowing. In a shipping canal between Antwerp and Brussels, described by a contemporary rowing magazine as both odoriferous and dreary, the 1920 rowing contest yielded likely results. American champions, British disappointment, and New Zealand's only medal of the games, Darcy Hadfield's bronze in the individual. Gold medalist in the singles, Grace Kelly's dad, interestingly enough. The eights event saw club teams rather than national teams, typical for this sport, a sport where teamwork, rhythm, and synchronicity are so important. The U.S. Naval Academy outrode the Leander Club, the champions last time around. Rugby. Returning officially after 12 years absence, rugby was only contested by two teams, America and France. The American team was from California's oldest colleges, Stanford and Santa Clara University, and they won 8-0 against the French, and that's all we know, so let's move on to the sailing. A ludicrous 16 events were planned for the sailing at various heights and sizes of boat. Most of the sailing was done in the nearest bit of ocean, the flat sheet of water near Ostend. Some of the smaller boats also raced around the Bootenai, a little shallow bay near Amsterdam. This massive amount of events and small amount of competitors, only 101 from six countries, meant there wasn't much competition. Five of the events had only two teams. Seven of the 16 events had only one competitor, literally guaranteeing victory if the boats made it past the buoys, and two of the events had zero entrants and were canceled. The races weren't very noteworthy, and in some cases, with only one entrant, it's unclear if they even happened at all, as they would have been a huge waste of time. Just give them the medals and move on. Nobody wants to just watch one boat slowly win. There weren't even any good boat names. The best was the British dinghy named Brat, but apparently Brat choked and broke halfway through the race. So, even there, you know. Shooting. Another sport with a bajillion events, the shooting. The revolver shooting yielded Brazil's first gold medal. Guilherme Parense nailed Raymond Bracken by 2 points. Most events were held at Beverloo, a military base in Leopoldsburg, 40 miles from Antwerp. The military base was still very much a hum from World War I in 1920. Within earshot of the American domination of the Olympic shooting, the Belgian military was using another part of the camp to dispose of leftover German hand grenades. If only they made that an Olympic event. Swimming. In a repeat of 8 years earlier, Duke Kahanamoku, the father of popular surfing, again won the sprint title, as well as anchoring the victorious American freestyle team. 8 years later, Duke was even better. Now world famous from his Olympic victory and surfing world tour, Duke would retire after these games and focus on surfing, and then run for sheriff of Honolulu County, a post where he would get reelected 13 times. Another old name was silver and bronze medalist Frank Beaurepaire, an Australian swimming star from the London 1908 Games. Unfortunately, he would get another silver, another bronze, but miss out on the gold, a feat he would repeat in Paris in 1924. In between Olympic performances, Beaurepaire would use his swimming prowess to save a man from a shark attack in Sydney, and use the £500 reward to start a successful tire repair chain.
Beaurepaire's, who you turn to for tires.
Like Duke Kahanamoku, Frank Beaurepaire would also pivot to elected office, first as the appointed Lord Mayor of Melbourne, then elected as a state legislator in the 1940s. The swimming was internationally competitive by the low standard of this games, but fewer records were broken than at the previous outing because of the Olympic ban on German and Austro-Hungarian swimmers. Tennis. According to sources, the courts were shoddy, and the competition was pretty shoddy too. Despite Japan's only two medals of the games, the tennis was yet again a story of missing stars. The biggest names of British and American tennis were absent. The Americans were gone because the Olympics, watched by a thin crowd of a few hundred, were held concurrently with the more prestigious American championships, watched by thousands. The British men also preferred to stay home, saving themselves for the bigger contests like Wimbledon. The British women, however, excelled, winning silver and bronze in singles and gold, and silver in doubles. It's also worth noting that while footage of this exists, it's this blurry-ass 2-second clip posted on the Olympics YouTube channel, which is almost worse than nothing. Tug of war. I'm not even mad at this one. They need to bring the sport back ASAP. This was the end of the line for this odd, troubled Olympic sport, unfortunately. Long the lightning rod for arguing, for some odd reason, and without much audience demand, the tug of war was cut for the next Olympics of Paris in 1924. Thankfully, it has returned in the World Games, but I can't get my tug of war fix from only one source. Unlike previous outings, this tug was actually pretty chill. There was no boot arguing like you may remember from before, just a straightforward tournament of the tuggers from five nations: Britain, the Netherlands, hosts Belgium, the United States, and Italy. Winners, a British team of coppers led to victory by a man named Harry Stiff. Water polo. What an international field at the sad, cold, dreary sewer swimming pool for the water polo matches. It's all European except for the USA and Brazil, but this is a genuinely very international match, especially for this games. Oddly, this was a tournament of lopsided matches to be expected in round one. In the quarterfinals, you had some blowouts. Sweden beat Czechoslovakia 11-0. Belgium beat Switzerland 11-0. The USA beat Greece 7-0. Britain beat Spain 9-0. But even in the semifinals, there were some really rough ones. Britain knocked America out of the game 7-2, but only squeaked by against Belgium in the final 3-2, clinching the silver. Weightlifting. Back by popular demand, perhaps, weightlifting is our final sport returning from the grave, albeit with its most successful athletes, the Germans, not allowed. In their stead, a procession of French and Belgian muscle men jerked it to victory. Wrestling. The story of the 1920 wrestling was one of complete Finnish domination. Finnish wrestlers won 5 of the 10 available golds, 5 of the silvers, and 2 of the bronzes. Very capable in the freestyle, but completely finishing anyone in the Greco-Roman wrestling. The Finnish team was likely helped by Germany's absence, but it's still a pretty impressive sweep. The most interesting wrestler, in my opinion, was Nat Pendleton, though, the American freestyle heavyweight silver medalist, who after his short Olympic career would go on to star as a tough guy in such films as Scared to Death, 6,000 Enemies, and Burn 'Em Up, O'Connor, as well as a memorable role as Bitsy Lamb in an episode of Schlitz Playhouse. Korfball. Finally, that's all the real sports dealt with. Let's conclude with the whimsical demonstration of korfball, which you may remember is a sort of off-brand basketball invented by a Dutch teacher in 1902. Korfball is notable and progressive in that it's mixed sex by design, with women and men on the same team, albeit in different roles. This must have been truly revolutionary in the 1920s. The game was initially dismissed by the IOC, but after several letters, they allowed a single game between Dutch clubs. The korfballers were placed in Olympic Stadium as a diversion while the audience waited for the marathon runners to come back. South Holland beats Amsterdam 2-0, and the weird game is apparently received warmly by the Flemish crowd. What more can I say of the Antwerp Olympiad? I've already talked far too much about this slice of sports non-history. It's a historical sporting event because of its context, not its content. The game's status is essentially allied propaganda, a benign assurance of alrightness organized by the mostly French, British, and American IOC overshadows the actual sporting accomplishments, and I feel compelled to talk about it more from a sense of completeness than an interest. Some world records were broken, but the absence of athletes from the former Central Powers meant a lot of the events were less exciting. Big stars just weren't there. The American team was dominant as usual, winning 29% of the golds and 25% of all the medals up for grabs, more than twice the golds of second place Sweden. Host Belgium did okay at fifth place, but really not much happened. The biggest personalities of the games, Kahanamoku and Kolomainen, were returning from more interesting games past. The whole thing was cheaply organized, cheaply prosecuted, and therefore not remembered by cameras or anyone. Even contemporaneous American newspapers mostly ignored the games. The passing of women's suffrage in the United States at the exact week of the games obviously pushed the games from the front page, but even on the sports page, they were more interested in pro baseball. Babe Ruth's potential leg injury outshines a whole day of Olympic coverage in this newspaper. I would normally also use this time to comment on any sort of dramatization or depiction of these specific games in the media, but of course, there aren't any. Why would you make a movie about Antwerp 1920? It would be a drag. Why did I just make this little movie about the Antwerp 1920 Olympics? Was this a drag? Anyway, see you guys in 4 years.
Marathon, marathon, marrow, marrow, marathon. Join us now, we're on a marathon.
We're always dancing when the music plays.